I call this meeting of the Williamsburg-James City County School Board to order. The first item of business, 2.02, Pledge of Allegiance. Mrs. Cook?
Yes, I'd like to introduce Garrett Bellin and Silas Cooper. Could you gentlemen come and lead us in the pledge? Both boys are rising eighth graders at Hornsby Middle School. Garrett is an honor roll student. He's on the basketball team, and he was selected to be a peer helper next year. Silas is in the National Junior Honor Society and plays soccer for a legacy.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Appreciate you gentlemen spending a little bit of your summer vacation with us. 2.03. Ms. Serza, could you take the roll, please?
Dr. Beers.
Here.
Ms. Cook.
Here.
Mr. Kelly.
Here.
Ms. Miner.
Here.
Mrs. Taylor.
Here.
Mrs. Young.
Here.
Thank you. Ms. Summel is in transit. Hopefully, we'll be here at some point in the evening. 3.01, certification closed session. We are not going to certify closed session. The board will be going back into closed session after this regular meeting, and at the end of that, we will have the closed session. 4.01, approval of the agenda. Can I have a motion for approval of the agenda?
Mr. Chairman, I move that the agenda be approved as presented.
For a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Moved and seconded for approval of the agenda. Ms. Serza?
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 5.01, announcement, superintendent's report. Dr. Costantino?
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. Saturday's graduations were eventful, to say the least. I'd like to thank the students and staff and family members who attended and who stuck with us despite a significant power outage at William & Mary Hall. I'd also like to publicly thank the staff of William & Mary for their efforts to get the generators running and for working with the power company to restore power as quickly as possible. We said goodbye to over 850 graduates from Jamestown, Lafayette, and War Hill High Schools on Saturday, and I wish each student happiness and success in their future endeavors. My second and final announcement is just to remind everyone that summer school is set to begin July 5th at J.B. Blayton, Hornsby, and Lafayette. Families needing more information on summer offerings should visit wjccschools.org and click on Summer School under the Our Schools tab at the top of the homepage. Late registration for high school courses begins June 23rd. Those are all the announcements I have this evening, Mr. Chair.
Thank you, Dr. Costantino. Are there any board members that have announcements or superintendent's reports? I would just like to piggyback upon the on the graduation, Dr. Costantino. Appreciate the William & Mary staff, but I also believe the administration did a great job in handling that event and keeping everyone informed as to the information they had, and I think Mrs. Bourgeois did a great job, and I appreciate all the effort of the administration to work with Dominion Power and the college to figure out what we were going to do next. 6.01, citizens' comments. Dr. Beers?
It is at this point in our meeting where citizens are invited to address the board. Those citizens desiring to speak have already submitted speaker cards to the clerk prior to the start of tonight's meeting. These speakers are asked to come to the podium when their names are called, state their names for the record, and direct their comments to the chair of the board. It is in the board's interest and desire that all comments are heard and respected. Hence, the citizens are asked to not engage in applauding, verbal outbursts, or any other type of demonstration during the presentations. Personal matters are not considered in public meetings. Therefore, the board requests that all speakers refrain from making reference to specific individuals in any form or fashion. Though the board does not respond to your comments are heard and appreciated. Each speaker is allocated 3 minutes to make their presentation, and the board asks that you respect this time limitation. Also, please be reminded that no time may be yielded to another speaker. Your acceptance and adherence to these guidelines will be greatly appreciated. Mr. Chair, my directions are completed.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. Mrs. Cook.
Amelie Drake.
Good evening. I'm Amelie Drake, speaking again as president of your local education association. As we close out another school year and begin planning for the next, it is my pleasure to announce that next year the president of our association is going to be the amazing Kim Hunley. While I've had the honor of representing our local educators and getting to work with you all, I know that you're in more than capable hands with Kim. Before I go, I want to offer a few quick thanks. First, thank you to all of our members for your trust and faith in me over the last 2 years. Thank you to our executive board for their undying support and their guidance. Thank you, Constantino, and to your entire staff. The communication, respect, and professionalism I've received has been incredible. And to the board and to the greater community, thank you on a professional and personal level for opening my eyes to the complexity that is education. For the first time, I saw beyond the four walls of my classroom and began listening and having a voice in the greater conversation surrounding public education. I will no longer shut my door and be unaware or uninvolved. That is a gift that it could have taken me years to experience, and one that many teachers never do. I feel incredibly blessed to have worked with such amazing people over the past few years, and have come so far in my thinking as a teacher, as a learner, and as a member of our community. So thank you again for your support, and it has been an absolute pleasure serving with you.
Thank you, Mrs. Drake. Ms. Drake.
The amazing Kim Hunley.
Pictures. Just seems like it was yesterday that I was standing before you saying that we were going to spotlight some talented students who wanted you all to have their artwork. And so Scott's going to tell you a little bit about these are his students from the middle school, and then I'll.
Jim, go ahead and hold these. I don't
okay, know. Yeah.
Trust there. Good evening, school board, Dr. Constantino. Back in March, our foreign language students participated in a project, and Ms. Taylor was there to go ahead and see that, in which they studied various artists from Picasso to Monet. And from their study, they created their own artwork. So what we did is we were able to take that artwork and bring them here. Some of the students we asked, some we did not, we went ahead and took it. One's hanging in my bathroom. They don't have a choice because they did some excellent work. It was beyond anything that I thought that they could do. So we share that artwork with you, and I'm one also that if you know someone who loves those artists from Picasso to Monet, also share it with them. And again, we thank you for working with us this year, and we look forward to start working again, actually in August, with a new teacher orientation.
Also, I wanted to say, she's going to, as you get one, if you could just hold it up so that the viewing audience can see. I wouldn't be standing here if it were for a test score, and I know that test scores are going to come out this summer and they're going to be all in the paper, and I just want you to remember my face when you see, you know, the percentage that didn't make it, because had it been for a test score, my SATs, I would not have probably been admitted into JMU during this era. Praxis test, as far as a teacher, I'm very creative, but not a good test taker. There are a lot of kids that have talent. As you see here, a lot of children have talent that does not show up on a test score. And I want you to remember that when you see those test scores. Yes, we have a lot of children doing amazing things, but we have a lot of children that if you ask them to do something through project-based learning, they'd knock your socks off. That's like me. I can do anything through project-based, but don't put it on paper and pencil. So I just wanted you to remember that this summer, and hopefully I slept till 10 o'clock today and feel really good, and so so you all get a lot, plenty of rest, get some vitamin D sunshine, and just remember that we thank you for all that you do, and I'll see you all in September.
Thank you, Ms. Sun.
Lafayette Jones, please.
Dr. Constantino, ladies and gentlemen of the board, and fellow attendees, it is with pleasure and a genuine feeling of elation that I am here tonight to acknowledge thanks from the community and the Bruton Heights alumni for your decision to change the name of Rawlsburg Elementary School. This decision represents and clearly defines the direction Williamsburg and James City County has taken to unify all of its citizens. This single action defines a significant historical moment in the growth and development of this great city and county. To date, we have received several name proposals from the community and numerous petitions supporting the decision for the name change. We also have developed a proposed naming process or procedure for the naming of our schools. Thank you for your valuable time.
Thank you, Mr. Jones.
Tony Short.
Hello. Hello to the board. Appreciate the opportunity. My name is Tony Short. I'm a local business owner, a Shorty's Diner, a varsity softball coach at Jamestown High School, and a 12U head coach of the Williamsburg Stars Gold Fast Pitch organization. As many on my team and other area teams across all the counties in our area, there are extremely talented rising sixth grade students that will be entering our middle schools this year that are strong enough both mentally, physically, to be allowed to participate in sixth grade middle school sports. As an example, this past season, some of the best travel ball players in sixth grade were deemed ineligible to play by rule. As a result, Hornsby Middle School, for instance, went from district champions last year in an undefeated season to 0-14 this year. Pitcher development is crucial to the success of a softball team, with one of the best pitchers in the area being in sixth grade and deemed unable to play. My plea to this board is to consider, much like the rest of area schools in the state of Virginia, the VHSL does allow for sixth grade eligibility. It has been a WJCC and York rule for a lot longer than my tenure here. Not sure of the exact date, but to not allow them to be allowed to play. When the question was asked, we emailed in as sixth grade students and why they weren't eligible. We received an email back from the coordinator of health and physical education for athletics, and the response was as follows. Their answer was, the transition from elementary to middle school is challenging, and the WJCC wants to make sure that all students have made this transition successful from an academic and social aspect. Our answer is, as coaches in the community, this is a great theory, but in all actuality, team sports will help build lifelong bonds and friendships, easing this transition, giving these students actually somewhere to be, a team to be a part of, mandatory study halls to participate in. Also, all club sports put academics first. This is very important to us as far as playing at the next level and so on. So maybe this could be one of those requirements that you could infract some sort of minimum GPA and or grades as well. Most travel ball and club sports students do practice multiple days a week and travel on the weekends, all while maintaining the honor roll. So we do really push for that. And it goes on to say a few other things, and I'm beating the clock. But in closing, please remember that sixth graders have always been allowed to be managers on sports teams. And what that does is a little contradiction to the answer. It requires 100% of their participation, both after school and everything that they do. They get a uniform, they practice, stay there, study halls, etc. They just do not play actually in the start of the games. This goes for all sports too, not just softball. If a student is good enough to make the team as a sixth grader and their parents allow it, the students should keep their grades as well, and they should be allowed to play. There is a revision this summer. As a varsity coach at Jamestown, I have seen a huge need for an extra year of development. In regards, we have not had a JV team in the high schools in the last 4 years. There's a revision this summer, and we would like to consider that into the handbook. Thank you so much for your
time.
Thank
you, Mr. Short.
Paul Smith.
Good evening, Chair Jim Kelly, school board members, and Superintendent Stephen Constantino. I am Paul Smith, school bus driver with 15 years of school bus driving experience. I would like to address the board at this time on two subjects. First, on the topic of referral forms, and second, on supplemental checks issued on the 10th of the month for bus drivers and aides. As you know, a task force has been established at this time, and I'm sure it has come up with some good proposals and effective solutions. I am either here to thank them for their prompt action or to encourage them and you to continue your search for a referral reform bus drivers, transportation staff, and administrators can all work with. On the second important topic, I'm here on behalf of many of the drivers to request you to bring back the supplemental check on the 10th of the month. There are many drivers having a hard time making ends meet on one paycheck at the end of the month. As you may not know, not too long ago, we were paid twice a month. With new technology came the elimination of our supplemental check. I beseech thee, on behalf of all those drivers, to bring back the supplemental check on the 10th of each month. Again, on behalf of all drivers and aides, I would like to thank you for undertaking the important concern of referrals. And I know you will undertake under advisement with the same fervor as you did with our request for referral reform, our request for bringing back the supplemental check on the 10th. And for that, we too are thankful.
Thank you, Mr. Smith, and thank you for all you do for our students and as a bus driver. Is that all? Thank you. Can I get a motion for approval of the consent agenda 7.01, approval of minutes from the following meetings, May 10th, 16, and May 24th, 16, 7.02, financial report and monthly bills and payroll, May 22nd, 7.03, personnel actions, 7.04, revised policy IGBB, programs for gifted students, 7.05, revised policy JHCD, administering medication to students, 7.06, revised policy JFC, areas of offense and their definitions, 7.07, release from compulsory attendance, case number R16-05.
Mr. Chairman, I move the consent agenda as approved. Presented. Sorry.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's a consent agenda. There's no discussion. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Thank you. 8.01, proposed agenda item, request for proposal number 16-11066, architectural services for the Lafayette High School gymnasium.
Thank you, Mr. Chair, members of the board. A request for the proposal was issued on the 17th of May, 2016, with a due date of June 15. This evening, Ms. Burda, Mr. Snipes, and we also have representatives from the county purchasing here to give you the information that we have collected. And also, we have placed this on the action item agenda this evening in the event that the board has the information that they need to make a decision. You would be able to take action this evening. Mr. Snipes.
Good evening, school board members. Dr. Constantino, this project includes architectural services to produce detailed designs, construction drawings, specifications, contract documents, and to obtain the necessary related regulatory approvals for the construction of the auxiliary gym at Lafayette High School. It's the division's intent to construct the auxiliary gym on the same parcel of land as Lafayette High School, and the scope of work for the project includes a program and schematic design phase, a design development phase, construction document phase, bid award and construction administration, and project closeout and system startup. As Dr. Constantino said, a request for proposal was issued on May 17th, 2016, with a due date of June 15, 2016. And with the assistance of county purchasing, a notice of the RFP was posted on the James City County Bulletin Board, emailed to contractors, and placed on the James City County and Williamsburg James City County Public School websites.
Any board members have any questions regarding this? We voted on this previously. What was the amount of that vote? Do we remember? It was like $222, I think it was.
$222,100.
And so then we went through the RFP process and we come out at $216,251. Any issue with period of performance to as far as being able to get this out for bid so that we can build this in time for 17-18 school year? Isn't that our goal?
That is our goal, correct.
Okay. All right. Are there any discussions, Dr. Constantino, we put this on as an action item and so that we can move this project forward. Anybody have a problem with voting on this as an action item tonight? Great. Thank you. So we'll leave it as 9.06 for the action item. 8.02 RFP number 16-8822, computer adaptive assessment tool. Dr. Constantino?
Mr. Chair, members of the board, we presented this item to you at our last meeting. There were a number of questions from the board, and we've collected some information. We've gone ahead and left it as a proposed agenda item to ensure that the board has all the information that it needs, and if we are still short of that, we still have time to make sure that you have that information, and our plan would be to place it on the July 12th agenda for action. Mr. Thorpe.
Mr. Thorpe.
Good evening, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. Thank you for the opportunity to come back and explain how our RFP process for our computer adaptive assessment tool has concluded. Our vendors submitted proposals by May 1st, 2016. Three of those vendors presented web demonstrations on May 23rd to us. And then after our first presentation at the June 7th board meeting, our evaluation team, our selection team, and our focus group committee experienced live demonstrations from Houghton Mifflin Harcourt and Northwestern Evaluation Association on June 9th. Just to take a step back, here are two components within a balanced assessment program. Our school division has tools that measure achievement, including that which determine how well students have met a performance target. With assessments that are designed for growth, teachers and teams can measure student progress over time and how and compare students' current performance with his or her own performance. A fair number of our students walk into a classroom and have already mastered a skill that a teacher has planned to present. Other students may be lacking the prerequisite skills necessary in order to embrace the skill that that teacher is teaching. A quality growth assessment tool can help a teacher to modify her or his instruction in order to meet both of these learners or both sets of these learners' needs in this scenario. Throughout this past school year, we have identified and received feedback related to the deficiencies of our current growth assessment tools. Specifically, it's fallen short of providing assessment outcomes that help to provide teachers for plan for future learning. It also does not report by a specific strand or category. It simply gives one score. It's also fallen short to provide outcomes that are predictive of future learning, and it's provided limited information with respect to student growth over time. And we currently use the Scholastic Math Inventory as our math growth tool in grades 3 through 9. We also use the Voyager Reading Assessment for students in grades 6 through 8 for student growth. Right now, we do not have a specific measure for student growth in reading in grades 3 through 5. Our selection committee has chosen the Northwest Evaluation Association's Measures of Academic Progress, or MAP, assessment. Here's a look at some of the comparisons between our SMI and Voyager and our reading and math measures of academic progress. Both would be the same in terms of the testing intervals. Both are and would be in the fall, winter, and spring for each student. For our SMI, we have one score that comes out that is a quantile, and for our Voyager, after each assessment, each student is given a lexile score. For our math and reading MAP, we would receive a proficiency score. It's called the RIT score, and then we would receive proficiency information by each specific strand within reading and math. For instance, for reading, that would be comprehension of nonfiction skills, comprehension of fiction skills, word analysis, and word reference. Additionally, with the reading and math MAP, it is predictive of students' future achievement 86 to 89% of the time. So, for instance, when a student would take a test in the fall of 2016, we would be given information, again, with 86 to 89% accuracy, whether that student will have had the proficient skills necessary in order to pass the 2017 SOL. Additionally, by level and by specific strand within reading or math, lessons and videos would be provided with the reading and math map. Let you take a look at some of the Virginia school partners that are currently using the measures of academic progress. Early in our process, we had considered many options for student groups who would take our growth assessments, and at one point in time, that was to be considered grades 2 through 10. That would have been approximately 8,000 students. We'd like to clarify the number of users. We are proposing and have budgeted for 5,632 students encompassing grades 3 through 8, as well as year-long students in Algebra 1 to take the math maps and the reading maps. Our total cost for the computer assessment tool is $72,699. That cost per student is $10.60. That also includes professional development for teachers and users in August and September. And again, we've gone through our users. So in terms of moving forward, here is how we project the rollout to be. We would provide training for teachers and staff with the test administration in August of 2016. We would go ahead and administer the fall reading math map and the fall math map in mid-September of 2016. We would then provide training for teachers based on that information, how to make instructional adjustments based on these test scores, and then we would go ahead and provide the winter and spring administrations as well, and continue to provide support for teachers in between test administrations as well. That's our presentation for this evening. Do you have any questions for me?
Ms. Young?
Thank you so much for the additional information. I do have several questions, though. Will Lexile scores continue to be used?
The reading map also provides a Lexile. It's a valuable measure because it can help to match readers to text.
Right, exactly. I think that's incredibly important. And you've answered my question about how many students are going to participate in this, the 5,000 number, and how many schools are going to participate in this?
All 15.
Okay. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Dr. Beers?
I guess a couple of questions. Scott, do we not have a standardized reading assessment now in any of these grades?
Yes, in middle school.
Yeah, we have it in middle school.
In the middle school, we've been using this past year, we used the Voyager reading assessment.
And we have them in the elementary grades as well?
We do not have a designated growth assessment tool. We have a diagnostic reading assessment, the DRA2, that it's a one-on-one teacher assessment.
I think it is important to have a standardized measure, and this is obviously what they're going to be doing. I guess what I'm curious about is are we going to make an attempt to sort of streamline that whole process and use the same instrument all the way through the grades?
Yes.
Because it's you know, you've got this test for those kids and you got this one for the other ones. So can I assume this is, and maybe Superintendent, you could probably answer this as well, is this sort of a starting point and we may expand that into those other grades?
I think right now we're looking at a common way to assess growth in grades, in the elementary and middle school grades.
I guess the question
when we look at ESSA, the federal legislation, and we read through what is going to be expected of states and what's going to be expected of localities, the issue of measuring growth of students becomes more prevalent than it's been under
sure.
No Child Left Behind. So whether or not the map is something that would be used beyond, I think, ninth grade algebra is where it would end, is yet to be determined.
So this isn't going to substitute for anything. It's going to be additional at the elementary grades.
This would take the place of the Scholastic Math Inventory. It would take the place of the Voyager.
Yeah. Mrs. Cook?
It seems to me that we're moving away from tools that aren't used by very many other divisions to ones that are, so I appreciate that. I have a question about the budget. If memory serves, the budget was a little less than what the cost is, I just want to make sure that we've got the funds to cover this, and it's...
We have funds within our cost center budget to cover, yes. Ms. Young?
Just one more question. I notice it's $10.60 per student, and that cost is going to be incurred annually?
Yes, ma'am.
And will that be included in the cost center budgeting?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Other questions? How long have we had our current assessment tool?
We have had Scholastic Math Inventory since 2013, and last year was our first year with the Voyager.
Well, what's the annual cost for that? Do you have a... No, I'm catching you kind of short on that.
I do. For the Scholastic product, their fee structure is after the first year, which was a student license fee, it's $350 per school. So it would be budgeted next year if we were to have it at $5,250 for the school division. And for the Voyager, now in year two, it would be $1.50 per student.
Okay, so we're going to a more expensive product, but we believe it's the value add there is worth it.
Yes.
Great. Is Algebra 1 too late to do a math assessment, or should there be something before?
When talking with our stakeholders, including our secondary math coordinator, we thought it was important to have longitudinal data, and Algebra 1 is thought to be very much a gateway math course, and this could help to support those students and help to inform teachers of year-long algebra.
But Algebra 1 is taken by the majority of students in ninth grade?
I don't have that information. I have the number of students.
Students.
I can get that information to you.
Okay. Thank you, Mr. Thorpe. I appreciate it. Takes us to our action items, 9.01, VSBA delegate and alternative delegate. Can I get a motion to approve the chair and the vice chair as VSBA voting delegate and alternate delegate?
Mr. Chair, I move approval of item 9.01, VSBA delegate and alternate delegate for vice chair and chair to serve in that capacity.
Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? Been moved and seconded for approval of the chair and the vice chair to be the VSBA voting delegate and alternate delegate. Ms. Sirza?
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 9.02, authorization of signature and absence of division superintendent. Can I get a motion to approve the authorization for Dr. Heron, Deputy Superintendent, and Mrs. Berta, Chief Financial Officer, to sign State Department of Education documents in the absence of the superintendent through June 30th, 2017.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we accept the authorizations of signatures in absence of the Division of Superintendent by Dr. Heron and Ms. Berta.
Second.
Second. Moved and second. Is there any discussion? It's moved and seconded to approve the authorization, Dr. Heron, Deputy Superintendent, and Mrs. Berta, Chief Financial Officer, to sign State Department of Education documents in the absence of the superintendent through June 30th, 2017. Mrs. Sirza?
Mrs. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. Authorization for VHSL membership. Can I get a motion for approval of Jamestown, Lafayette, and War Hill High Schools for membership in the Virginia High School League for the 2016-17 school year?
Mr. Chair, I move that we moved for approval of the authorization for VHSL membership.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's moved and seconded for approval of the Jamestown, Lafayette, and War Hill High School's membership in the Virginia High School League for the 2016-17 school year. Mrs. Serza?
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 9.04, Title 1A, 2A, and 3A Consolidated Federal Grant Funding Application for 2016-17. Can I get a motion for approval of the Consolidated Federal Programs Grant Application for the 2016-17 school year?
Mr. Chairman, I move the application for Title 1A, 2A, and 3A Consolidated Federal Grant Funding Application for 2016-17.
Is there a second?
Second.
It's been moved and seconded for approval of the Consolidated Federal Grants Program Grants Application for the 2016-17 school year. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 9.05, 2016-17 Code of Conduct. Can I get a motion to approve the 2016-17 Code of Conduct as presented?
Mr. Chair, I move to approve the 2016-17 Code of Conduct as presented.
Thank you. Is there a second?
Second.
Is there any discussion? It's been moved and seconded for approval of the 2016-17 Code of Conduct as presented. Ms. Serza?
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. 9.06, Contract Award for Request for Proposal 16-11-066. Can I get a motion to approve the award of Proposal 16-11-066, Architectural Services for the Lafayette High School Auxiliary Gymnasium to HBA in the amount of $166,116?
So moved.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. Any discussion? Looking forward to getting this finally moving again. It's been moved and seconded to award request for proposal number 16-11-066, Architectural Services for the Lafayette High School Auxiliary Gymnasium to HBA in the amount of $166,116. Mrs. Serza?
Dr. Beers?
Aye.
Ms. Cook?
Aye.
Ms. Miner?
Aye.
Mrs. Taylor?
Aye.
Mrs. Young?
Aye.
Mr. Kelly?
Aye. Thank you. That brings us to our policies 10.01, new policy FFA school names. Somebody from the policy committee want to discuss this? Or should I go Dr. Constantino?
We presented to the policy committee the draft policy and also the VSBA draft policy. And the policy committee has brought forward their recommendation for your consideration.
Mrs. Young and I solicited input from all of you and went through that during the policy committee meeting, and essentially what is before you is aligns very closely with the VSBA policy, but if you read the first line of the third paragraph, that is language that was submitted to us by our attorney that essentially grandfathers every school that wouldn't currently comply with this policy. So so that's what we present to you and as the first reading. Do you have anything?
No.
Any comments on the policy?
Clarification. I saw that the change to grandfather the names was in place, but the other question I have is there is a comment about absent extraordinary circumstances. I was wondering what that the impact of that or what purpose or what would be extraordinary circumstances, I guess.
Well, I think that would be up to, so our discussion about that was that it would be up to any given board to determine that for themselves. It's in the VSBA, but if it's problematic, I'm sure we can discuss it.
So it appears to give a caveat that you could name for someone for a school that's has not been deceased less than 10 years if that was under an extraordinary circumstance. Is that how I read that?
I don't read it that way.
Okay.
I think that we shouldn't name schools after people until they've been deceased for at least 10 years. And I think one of the things that just needs to be pointed out is that regardless of who you name a school after, people are fallible. We are. And who knows 50 years from now what will be discovered about what we name any school. So I think that's probably part of the absent extraordinary circumstances. And it's also left open that future school boards can change school names if something such as the Rawlsburg situation comes up. So
if the board wants to strike that phrase, that's fine.
How do you read that? What does absent extraordinary circumstances? Not to put you on the spot there, but so if you take out that naming the school or school district for an individual, the school board will consider naming such facility only for individual who's been seized for less than 10 years.
Right.
So if you put absent extraordinary circumstances in there, that appears to be a caveat that allows
right.
you to get around the individual who has been deceased for at least 10 years.
Likewise, the last paragraph talks about the board may rename a school facility. So I think that this policy provides sufficient flexibility for any board to do.
Right.
But I think it's a guideline.
In the last... You know, the last clause which says we'll consider naming such a facility doesn't say we'll only name a facility for.
Mm-hmm.
So I mean, there's
right.
there is still flexibility in that.
Right. But I mean, I don't know. Are you comfortable striking?
I'm comfortable striking that. I think it is confusing.
Yeah, I think we should strike that. So absent the extraordinary circumstances. Does anybody have an issue with leaving it or not leaving it or an opinion? Okay. Good. Okay. All right. So we will. I guess we bring that for a second reading at the in July 12th.
The only question I have, I'm trying to find the. Where is that? Where's the grandfathering language?
Effective with adoption of this policy. Among other requirements,
okay.
and effective with
and
adoption
effective
of this policy.
When?
So when you vote to approve it, from that point forward, this policy is in effect. So.
Okay.
And the attorneys handed us that language, Dr.
Right.
For that exact
for that
circumstance and
yep.
purpose. So we will bring that for a second reading at the next board meeting in July. What, with the extraordinary circumstances?
It's very lawyer-like.
It's what we pay our attorneys to do for us.
It is indeed. 10.02, revised policy JN Appendix A, student fee schedule. Dr. Constantino?
Here are members of the board. The Code of Virginia 22.1253.13-7 requires school board shall maintain and follow up to date policies. All policies shall be reviewed, and the rationale are changes in charges and students' fees was last revised quite some time ago. Mrs. Bird is here to answer any questions you might have, or the policy committee may want to discuss as well.
Evening, Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Constantino. Before you tonight is an updated fee schedule for the 2016-17 school year. There are no revisions to the actual policy, JN, that guides this. This is the appendix to JN, and we are required to bring this to you annually before we can authorize fees to be charged in the school. These fees are for items that are course-related, however, not curriculum-based, so there are additional materials that are requested by teachers to support their instructional material that we provide as a division. If a student is unable to pay due to economic situations, there is a process to file a waiver annually. That waiver form is also included in the policy as an exhibit, and a regulation defines how that waiver form is requested. The basis for that is the free and reduced lunch population. That's how we guide our template for who is approved and not approved for the waiver of fees. There are only minor changes to the fee schedule, one being the presentation. It's more consolidated to give it a better appearance and hopefully make it easier to understand when it's included in the student handbook. And also, there was only one removal, and that was the middle school technology fee, and one adjustment to English paperback books to make sure that it was designated that that was only for AP classes. And in prior fee schedules, it said based on cost. So we have defined that range of cost per book, which is $3 to $6 per book. I'll be happy to entertain any questions related to this. This has been before the policy committee.
Are there any questions from board members? We fundamentally, every year we fundamentally struggle with this because free and appropriate public education is just, so we've had this discussion every year since I've been on the board about that. Now, do you know how many students apply for the waiver? Do we have
I doubt.
And I guess my question is, are we proactive in giving them that material, or are we reactive waiting for them to?
Supposed to be provided to parents annually, and I believe the schools do that.
Okay. So,
and it's posted on the website as well.
Yeah, so for those students who are on free and reduced lunch, you know, I'd just like to, I guess I would like to make sure that they get that proactively versus reactively, you know, where they have to go ask for it, know to ask for it. And I guess that's my question, is how do they know to ask for that waiver of the fee? So do we have a feel for how much we collect in fees annually?
Yes. Approximately $107,000 in materials for elementary, middle, and high together for student fees. Just for the course materials, not parking and all of that, course materials.
Oh, so just for the course materials.
The athletic fee, what's that? What's the total for that?
I don't know that right off the top, but I can get that to you.
Now, is that... that's been Land High School. I'm just curious to see how much it is, and what you know, is that the funding that's used to support the teams, or is there additional source of revenue for them?
It is used to support the division cost. The division cost for athletics is over $1 million. So this fee does offset a portion of that, while it's a small portion.
Should be able to tell you what those numbers are. I think it's like 50 for the first sport and 45 for the second, or 40 for the second. There's some
$60 per high school athletic sport and $50 per middle school sport, but I don't know the number of athletes.
Yeah, I thought the second sport was less, and I think that money goes to the athletic fund for the high school. I don't know. Be that as it may, but every year we struggle with this, but I guess it's a necessary evil. Any other comments from board members?
As we move from consumables into using technology more, do we anticipate transferring some of those fees for the use of the technology, or are we just going to try and phase everything out? I mean,
the instruction team is evaluating the real purpose behind some of these fees, and they will probably transition them out.
I agree with the chair about, we read that our constitutional responsibility is for a free system of education and secondary public education, and then we have fees, and I know they're allowed and permitted, but for charging, we want to encourage people to take 4 years of foreign language, and it's good that we don't have barriers for those who are lower socioeconomic levels, but there are families who have 2, 3, 4 youngsters in school who are taking foreign language. It starts to get to be, or banned, it starts to get to be quite a costly public education.
And that is a concern of the instructional team and administration as well. We've had those internal conversations.
Thank you. That brings us to 11.1, board member comments. Are there any comments from board members today? Ms. Young?
First of all, I just wanted to compliment the cabinet for their work during the graduation. I was, it was a fun experience, and I thought, except for the power outage, which nobody had any control over, I want to commend the cabinet and the superintendent for its dedication and commitment to make this I think it was a great event for students and for families, and I thought it was amazing. I thought you did an excellent job. And secondly, I just want to talk for a moment. I attended the NSBA Advocacy Institute, which at the institute, it addressed the ESSA. We heard from Secretary King and Lamar Alexander, or Senator Alexander, and Senator Lamar Alexander expressly stated, and I think this is a good heads up for our school division, that the intent of the law is to return more control of education to states and localities, and I'm sure the Virginia Department of Education is looking at that, and the Senate has established an oversight committee to ensure proper implementation of ESSA. And in fact, last Friday, Senator Warner asked that his office be notified if there is a DOE overreach. And I can almost guarantee there will be one, because the other person that spoke was Secretary King, who was already talking about regulations that they wanted to institute. So just a heads up, because I think from what I heard from the senators is they want the school divisions to have much more autonomy, which I think, well, to allow teachers to teach and to get back to having some creativity, which I, as a former teacher, I don't know how I would have done in a climate where all I had to do was prepare for tests. So I just thought that was very interesting, and it was, they didn't have them debate, which I'm very thankful for.
Thank you. Ms. Taylor?
To echo Ms. Young's sentiments, I would like to commend the WJCC staff for their wonderful graduation on Saturday, even though we missed out on the laser light show that we thought was coming when the lights went out. We were anticipating that, but that did not happen. But it was wonderful, just the same, and thank you for that.
Thank you. Ms. Minor?
I'd like to add my congratulations to the cabinet and for their quick thinking and their flexibility in solving our issue. I also want to say that it was remarkable how the students and the parents and everyone in attendance, when the lights went out, responded. It was calm, and people were rational and were patient, and it was quite amazing. And then the other observation I'd love to make is that at graduation, we recognize the students, and we recognize all the work the faculty has done to bring them to this point, and the staff. And we do talk about parents, but it's amazing how many of our youngsters have not only their parents, but their aunts and uncles and brothers and sisters and neighbors who come and support them, sometimes raucously, but they're there to congratulate their students on their success, and that is a wonderful thing. And finally, I'd like to thank the folks at Hornsby for inviting me to their stepping up ceremony for the eighth graders who are going on to high school. It was a fun event. There were as many middle school eighth graders, actually there are more middle school eighth graders than there were students at each of our graduations. And again, on a 2 o'clock on a Thursday afternoon, the War Hill Gymnasium was packed with family and friends and relatives and cousins who were recognizing these youngsters' achievement. And I'd like to thank Mr. Hill for his comments about, we expect to see you in 2020 and we expect to see you in 2024. And I have to say, for our youngsters that graduated on Saturday, I'm hoping that we will see them in 2020 completing their training in education and advanced studies. This is the best time to be a school board member. It's a great, great opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you. Dr. Beers?
Yeah, I would echo that very strongly and congratulate all the high school seniors who graduated, and not just congratulate them because they've come, it's sort of, it is a commencement, but it's also the end of their career in the Williamsburg James City County Schools. But I also want to congratulate the teachers who worked with them over the years, the administrators who helped, the teachers who helped the students over the years, especially thanking the parents and grandparents and other extended members of the family that because of a previous commitment, I was unable to be at the graduation ceremony. But I just think that it is it's a family enterprise that also involves a first-rate school system, and I think we really have that.
Thank you, Dr. Beers. Mrs. Cook?
I'd like to echo, just ditto on everybody for the graduation. Thank you. It was an exceptional job under extraordinary circumstances, so thank you. I also like to extend thanks for the Lafayette auxiliary gym process, for everyone who worked on that. Appreciate that. Last week, 2 weeks ago, I attended the early college event honoring the War Hill students who had had attended Thomas Nelson last semester, and it was fabulous. It's a great program. I'm looking forward to watching the growth of that program over time. And then last Friday, Senator Mark Warner hosted an event, and I just want to thank the school board members who were there, and thank especially Mr. Kelly and Mrs. Young for your thoughtful questions. You opened the door to feedback, and that's important, and I think it's an important opportunity.
Thank you. A couple of things. I'd like to thank Ms. Drake for her service as the president of the Education Association. It's been great getting to know you and working with you and talking with you about school things. I hope this Hundley character can do the same as you are. You know, I've only known her since every day I've been on this board since 2010. And I'd like to thank Mrs. Hundley for all the great artwork that you've given us over the last year. It looks great on my wall, and I'm worried that some parents going to want to come get their artwork back because it's really amazing stuff, and it's really amazing to see what our kids do. And we look forward to working with you as the president of the Education Association. I would like to echo the sentiments that I mentioned earlier and that several board members talked about with the high school graduations. But I'd also like to thank all the board members who attended. We had pretty much a full house there at graduations across the front row, and I appreciate you spending your day on one of the most gorgeous days of the summer that we've had. Why the power chose to go out on that day, no one will ever know, but I appreciate all the board members who were in attendance and the support for the students and the parents and all that were at the graduations. Since we have been here last, Mrs. Cook mentioned the early college celebration at War Hill, but we also went to the GED graduations, and several board members attended that. The GED students and completion, that is no easy feat to get through the GED program, particularly the way they revamped the test to make them computer-based and the technology that's required for that. And just the stick-to-itiveness and want-to that you have to do to get the GED. And so I am very proud of those graduates, and they should be justly proud of themselves. So appreciate the board members who were in attendance at all of the events that we have had in June. That I'll move to 12.01, upcoming events. We have a policy committee meeting on July 12th at 1:30. I would like to put on the policy committee's agenda to look at the SOPs and our board SOP, and kind of take a look at some of the ways we want to evaluate and look at things we change. So I don't know if you can do that, if you can begin that process on your July 12th meeting, but if in going forward we take a look at that and board members want to get their comments on the SOP to Mrs. Cook and Mrs. Young, I would appreciate that, to have them begin taking a look at that. We have a VSBA education conference on July 19th in Richmond. I have to say that after the last few months, this meeting and events things is starting to ease up a little bit, so it's good. Summer's good for everybody. So our next closed session, our next meeting of the school board will be July 12th at 6 o'clock at the Stryker Center in closed session. Followed by a work session and open and action items at 6:30, also at the Stryker Center. And then we are back here on August 2nd at 6 o'clock, a closed session in the work session room in Building F here, and then a regular meeting following that at 6:30 on August 2nd. With that, I will not adjourn. We will go in recess as the board to continue our closed session, and we will start that in 10 minutes, if the board can do that. So thank you all for coming, and have a great summer. We are in recess.